سيدنا نبينا محمد وعلى اله وصحبه اجمعين. So now we will continue with the Kitab al-Aqidiyah, and we'll start reviewing for what has been discussed before in the previous days, inshallah. But there are very important meanings, even for someone that just joined now, very important meanings and principles that explain to us the foundation of this deen and how to fulfill the meaning of al-Aqidiyah as it should be. And many of us, many of the Muslims today, when we have a distorted understanding of the meanings of the deen, is because a person has to take the deen from its right sources. And the Prophet ﷺ, as he mentioned in the hadith in Surah Abu Dawud, and it's a sound hadith, he said, تَسْمَعُونَ وَيُسْمَعْ مِنْكُمْ وَيَسْمَعُ مِمَّنْ سَمِعَ مِنْكُمْ. This hadith ulama that was mentioned of how the religion comes to us from one generation to the other, from the chain of the people of knowledge. تَسْمَعُونَ, that means you're listening to me. وَيُسْمَعُ مِنْكُمْ, he's talking to the Sahaba رضي الله عنه. And people would listen from you. وَيَسْمَعُ مِمَّنْ سَمِعَ مِنْكُمْ, and it will be also listened from the one that listened from you. And then, of course, this shows how even the context of the hadith, it's not just that that's it and that's the end of it. It's just giving us the clarity that the matter is from one generation to the other. This ilmi, this deen, is to be taught and for people to learn it from one generation to the other. And therefore, when we understand words like what is the meaning of Ubudiyya, what is the meaning of that, this is the foundation of our deen, how to fulfill that meaning, we find many distorted beliefs even that people might have. So we have to understand the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and these anfal and these terminologies from the Quran and the Sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ, the way it was at the time of the Prophet ﷺ and the early generations of Islam, and to have that hope for the rewards from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You know, and there's always blessing when a person comes to the house of Allah. You might be hoping for something, but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bestows something else for you, or something even more. As long as a person is having, as we're talking about the ikhlas, when a person has sincerity and sidq and truthfulness, nobody can imagine what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will bestow upon this individual and in his heart with the meanings of an iman, with guiding that person to be upon the right knowledge. And as Aisha radiallahu anha, she mentioned in the ayah of Surah Al-Qasas and others, when Musa alayhi salam, when he said to his family in Kutu, إِنِّي أَنَسْتُ نَارًا لَعَلِّي أَتِيكُم مِنْهَا بِقَبَسٍ أَوْ أَجِدُ عَلَى الْمَنِي هُدًى. He said to his family, he was traveling. It was said they were lost, and they found light when they're going back from Madian to Misr. Then when he saw the fire, and he said to his family, stay, I will get maybe a part of the fire for them to be warm and not to be cold, or maybe he would find someone to guide them. This is what he hoped for. And he came back with what? With prophethood. And she said, Kulu, Aisha, and this is how they used to move their hearts with the Quran. Ayah that many people that maybe not pay attention to. She said, Kulu, lima la tarju, arja, mimma tarju. Be to what you do not even hope for, more hopeful than the things that you hope for. Right? Meaning from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You hope from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you have the raja from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to matters of dunya, to guide us, to give us knowledge of the deen, matters of worldly matters, the hereafter to make a person enter Jannah. Be hopeful to the things that you do not even know that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will bestow it upon you, more than the things that you hope for, because nothing is the like of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows of what's best for us is beyond what we think. We're so limited. And that's why even when a person have a calamity in his life, or being tested with something that he doesn't like in his life, he's so limited, he thinks that this is something bad happens to him and he's going through things that requires patience and so on. If he knows the qadr of Allah, if he knows what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala prepared for him, if he's sincere, if he's truthful, if he's seeking the words of Allah, it's far beyond what that person would hope for. And that's nothing is the like of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and his tadbeer and his qadr and his mercy subhanahu wa ta'ala. So one of which is when a person takes the means to study the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with sincerity, with truthfulness. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He is the bestower of all favors. And as also this morning we talked about Surah Al-Takathur, ثُمَّ لَتُسْأَلُنَّ يَوْمَئِذٍ عَنِ النَّعِيمِ. You will be asked on that day in the Day of Judgment about al-na'im, the delight of this world. The sahha, the mal, health and wealth and free time and all kinds of things. But as Muhammad ibn Ka'b, he said in the tafsir of the ayah, what is this na'im also? He said, Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. You will be asked about the Prophet. This is the greatest ni'mah that a person can have, is to be a follower of the Prophet alayhi sallam, to get to know what is right and what is wrong, the deen of Islam. So people will be asked about this. So how can we then be truthful in this? We have to learn the matters of the deen and to be patient, knowing the way of the Prophet alayhi sallam. So going back to the subject of Al-Umudayn. And one point, and this is again with you, and this lecture has been mentioned before, inshallah ta'ala, and it's, I guess it's recorded somewhere. He talks about the subject of people are not in the same level of an iman. As it's very clear. Some people have strong iman, some people they have weak iman. And this is in page number 18. And he mentioned the famous hadith of the Prophet with regards to al-shirk, أَخْفَ مِنْ دَبِي مِنَّمْ, that it's more hidden than the footsteps of the ants, with regards to al-shirk, which is the minor shirk and the riyad, the like of it, showing off. And also the hadith, تَعِسَ عَبْدُ الدِّرْهَمْ, تَعِسَ عَبْدُ الدِّينَارِ, تَعِسَ عَبْدُ الْقَطِيفَةِ, تَعِسَ عَبْدُ الْخَمِيصَةِ, تَعِسَ وَانْتَكَسْ وَإِذَا شِيكَ فَلَمْ تُخِشْ, إِنْ أُعْطِيَ رَضِيَ وَالْمُنِعَ سَخِطْ. And also we heard this hadith many times before. He is miserable, whether it's a dua or stating a fact. He's miserable, the slave of the dirham, the slave of the money, the slave of the dinar. Even the dirham is smaller than the dinar. So the same thing with whatever money, dollars and things like this. Ta'is Abdul Khatifa. He's miserable, the slave of the Khatifa, special type of clothing. And the Khamisa, another different types of clothing. The different wealth that people have in this life, he's inverted. He's ta'is wa takas wa ila shika falam tuqish. If something hard happens to him, may Allah not make it easy for him, or he would never find it easy, find it very major, because he sees the smallest thing as something great. In U'tiya, the signs of that person, the slave of all these materialistic things, if he's given, he's pleased. And if he is withheld from him anything, sakhit, he's displeased and he's opposing or saying why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is doing this to me, and so on. What is that related to Al-Ubudiyya? The Prophet ﷺ mentioned Abd. Al-dirham, the slave of the dirham, the slave of the dinar, the slave of these types of wealth. And he says, this is the state, وَهَكَذَا حَالْ مَنْ كَانَ مُتَعَلِّقًا بِرِئَاسَةٍ أَوْ بِصُورَةٍ وَنَحْوِ ذَلِكَ مِنْ أَهْوَاءِ نَفْسِهِ. Page number 81. And the same thing, وَهَكَذَا مَنْ عَبَدَ الْمَالِ. The person that worship wealth, worship an image, a human being, worship a position. And what is the meaning of worshipping it? This is, as he says, فَهَذَا عَبْدُ مَا يَهْوَاهُ مِنْ ذَلِكَ هُوَ رَقِيقٌ لَهُ إِذِ الرِّبْكُ وَالْعُبُودِيَّةِ فِي الْحَقِيقَةِ هُوَ رِبْكُ الْقَلْبِ وَعُبُودِيَّتُهُ. The real slavery is the slavery of the heart. This is the الْحَقِيقَةِ. People always look for the reality of things. Because as agreed upon, people are deceived in this life. And there are things that has its apparent looks or meanings to it, and the reality of it is something else. And if a person wants to see the reality of things, he has to have the knowledge of it, and to see the end of it. What's the end of it? What's the outcome of it? How that thing will be in the hereafter? This is the reality of it. So kufr is never to be something good, because the end of it is misery and hellfire. And that is what is good. Even if a person in that immediate life, the matter is not as he would wish or would he like. So the reality of what is the real slavery is when a person's heart is enslaved. فَمَا اسْتَرَقَّ الْقَلْبَ وَاسْتَعْبَدَ فَالْقَلْبُ عَبْدُ. Whoever the heart is enslaved by something, the heart is then becomes a slave to that thing. As said, الْعَبْدُ حُرُّ مَا قَلْعَ وَالْحُرُّ عَبْدُ مَا قَلْعَ. The slave, this subject of a free man versus a slave. You know, not the physical one. This is, yes, established and it used to be present. But there is slavery which exists today, basically, right? If we apply this, there is slavery exists today, which is the slavery of the heart. Physically, a person feels or he thinks that he's a free man, but he's enslaved. And as the slide of poetry by Kindi Adar is that Al-Abd Hur, the slave, the one that is physically enslaved, is free if he's content, meaning if his heart has contentment. وَالْحُرُّ عَبْد, and the free person is a slave if he's always having that zeal and eagerness and greed and the like of this. He's enslaved to what he is having that greed of. And this is the subject of At-Tama. Umar ibn Khattab radiallahu anhu, he said, At-Tama'u faqr, وَالْيَأْسُ غِنًا, وَإِنَّ أَحَدَكُمْ إِذَا يَأْسَ مِنْ شَيْءٍ اسْتَغْنَى. He said, At-Tama'u. At-Tama'u is when a person is greedy, he wants something, and this is something that occupies him. He becomes enslaved to it. This is faqr. This is by itself is poverty. He's in need. Why? Because he always feels that he doesn't have unless he attain whatever he is seeking. وَالْيَأْسُ غِنًا, and to give up on something of that is not of an important for you, it's ghina, you become rich, you're not enslaved to it. And he said, in one of you, if you give up on something, you become not in need of it. For example, if you give up on having the most expensive car, there's no way that you can have a car with, for example, worth $1 million, right? Because you even cannot get a car for $5,000, right? You have that feel that you don't need that expensive car. You're not being tortured in your life because you don't have that most expensive car, right? But if you have something close, but you cannot have that fully, I mean, maybe just if you work harder, you'll get it, you'll find yourself enslaved because you want that most expensive car. This is basically the meaning of it. Once you feel that you in not in need of something, you become rich from that thing. You're not dependent on that thing. He says, وَهَذَا أَمْرٌ يَجِدُهُ الْإِنسَانُ مِنْ نَفْسِهِ فَإِنَّ الْأَمْرَ الَّذِي يَيْأَسُ مِنْهُ لَا يَطْلُبُهُ. Human being, find this in himself. Something that you have no chance to attain it, you won't find yourself going after it because there's no way that you can have it. So you find yourself not going after it. وَلَا يَطْمَعُ فِيهِ وَلَا يَتَقَلُّهُ فَقِيرًا إِلَيْهِ. And his heart will never be in that state of being in need of it. And I hope that your patient will be follow the thought here and what he's saying, because it's a very benefiting knowledge for the heart to have that strength of an iman and to be slaves of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone. يقول, the heart will never be then in need of it. وَلَا إِلَى مَنْ يَفْعَلُ, and not even attached or longing for the one that is doing this thing that you have no chance to have it. وَأَمَّا إِذَا طَمِعَ فِي أَمْرٍ مِنَ الْأُمُورِ وَرَجَاءٍ. But if you have a hope in something, right, what happens? فَإِنَّ قَلْبَهُ يَتَعَلَّقُ بِهِ. His heart becomes attached to it. فَيَصِيرُ فَقِيرًا إِلَى حُصُولِهِ. He becomes faqir, in need to have it. وَإِلَى مَنْ يَظُنُّ أَنَّهُ سَبَبٌ فِي حُصُولِهِ. And he becomes attached and in need to that person that he thinks that he can give him or he can get that thing from him. يَقُولُ هَذَا فِي الْمَالِ وَالْجَاءِ وَالصُّوَرُ وَغَيْرِ ذَلِكَ. This is in the materialistic things. Wealth, status, human beings. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said about Ibrahim alayhi salam, فَبْتَغُوا عِنْدَ اللَّهِ الرِّزْقَ وَعْبُدُوهُ وَاشْكُرُوا لَهُ إِلَيْهِ تُرْجَعُونَ. فَبْتَغُوا, seek with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and عند الله mentioned first. Seek with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala الرزق, the provisions. وَعْبُدُوهُ, and worship Him. وَاشْكُرُوا لَهُ, and be grateful to Him. Is any makhluk is mentioned here? No makhluk, no creation of Allah. You seek in the rizq from Allah. You're worshipping Allah. You're grateful to Allah, إِلَيْهِ تُرْجَعُونَ, because everybody shall return to Allah. So why then being attached to a makhluk? And the more the heart is detached from the makhluk, the more that he will be able to fulfill the ubudiyyah to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala perfectly. And then, again, with reason, as we follow this, فَالْعَبْدُ لَمُدَّ لَهُ مِنْ رِزْقٍ. The slave of Allah, every human being, he's in need. By necessity, he has to have provisions, he has to have rizq, money, food, and so on. وَهُوَ مُحْتَاجٌ إِلَى ذَلِكَ, and he is in need of it, no doubt. Then he says, فَإِذَا طَلَبَ رِزْقَ مِنَ اللَّهِ صَارَ عَبْدًا لِلَّهِ. If he asks his provisions from Allah, he becomes a slave of Allah. فَقِيرًا إِلَيْهِ, in need of Allah. وَإِذَا طَلَبَهُ مِنْ مَخْلُوقٍ صَارَ عَبْدًا لِذَلِكَ الْمَخْلُوقِ. And if he asks his rizq, his provision from a makhluk, from a creation of Allah, he becomes a slave to that makhluk. فَقِيرًا إِلَيْهِ, in need of him. وَلِهَذَا كَانَتْ مَسْأَلَةُ الْمَخْلُوقِ مُحَرَّمَةٌ فِي الْأَصْلِ. Then he goes into the subject of al-mas'ala, begging. It's forbidden in its original ruling, unless a person is in type of necessity, going to people and asking them for their money. أن الأحاديث لا تزال مسألة بأحدكم حتى يأتي يوم القيامة وليس في وجهه مزعة من لحم. The مسألة people asking for people's money, meaning that with a person working and he wants his paycheck at the end. No, this is someone that is going after the money of people, begging from them. That a person will keep on doing this till he comes in the day of judgment without a piece of flesh on his face. So it shows that this is not permissible to start with, unless the person is in dire need, as it's mentioned also in the hadith of the Prophet ﷺ, as he mentioned this in page number 83, لا تحل المسألة إلا لغرم مفضع أو دم موجع أو فقر مدقع. Even the hadith is, the sanad of the hadith is weak, but the meaning of it is correct. And it's mentioned also in other hadith, which is the mas'ala to ask for people's money, it is not permissible unless a person has a terrifying loss or debt, not any need, mufdir, that means it's great, something huge, that he cannot save himself, they'll put him in prison for it, something like this. Awdami muja, blood money or something that he is in pain of, that to push away this, or faqr mutqa, or poverty, not faqr, not normal faqr, but mutqa, means that he cannot even sustain his life. The necessities of his life is not there. So he mentioned the subject, which is su'al, or asking others in the hadith of the Prophet ﷺ, richness from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, making rich, when yasta'ifu yu'ifhahu Allah, and when yasabbar yusabbirhu Allah, وَمَا أُعْطِيَ أَحَدٌ عَطَاءً خَيْرًا وَأَوْسَعَ مِنَ الصَّبْرِ. Nobody is given more spacious giving or ata or gift better than sabr, more spacious than sabr. And as this hadith is also mentioned, that whoever seek means of virtue, he will attain it, which is also one of the ways of Allah. These are principles in our life that a person should never miss. If you want something good, then you have to take the means for that good to happen. If you turn away from something good, the goodness would not come and run after you. It would leave you and go away. This is how al-khayr is with the person. If a person turns away from al-khayr, the khayr will run away from him. So this is how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created the people. So the Prophet ﷺ, when he said to khawas the ashab, and this is again a high level, not that something that is mandatory for every person to be upon. But when the Prophet ﷺ, when he asked special ones of the companions of Allah عنه, أَلَّا يَسْأَلُ النَّاسَ شَيْئًا, that they don't ask the people for anything. And وفي المسند أن أبا بكر رضي الله عنه كان يسقط الصوت من يده فلا يقول أحدنا يولي إياه. أبو بكر رضي الله عنه, the stick would fall from his hand and he won't say to anyone, give it back to me. He would do it himself. ويقول إن خليلي أمرني ألا أسأل الناس شيئا. Said my friend the Prophet ﷺ ordered me not to ask the people anything. And in Sahih Muslim that Auf ibn Malik said that the Prophet ﷺ bayya'ahu fi ta'if, he gave him the pledge of Islam, wa asarra ilayhim kalimatan khafiyya. The Prophet ﷺ said to them something not secret, but not everybody heard it. ألا تسألوا الناس شيئا. Do not ask people anything. And these people that the Prophet ﷺ said that to them, how they followed that order to the Prophet ﷺ, and he said it only to them, so that it's not like something different from, it's permissible to ask people for things that they're able to do. But these special ones, when they heard this from the Prophet ﷺ, and how they would follow the orders of the Prophet ﷺ, none of them, even if a stick falls on them, he would get it himself and not ask anyone for to give it to him. And he says this issue then leads to the nusus, the text in the Quran and the Sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ, comes على الأمر بمسألة الخالق, to ask the خالق. How many verses in the Quran talks about asking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? والنهي عن مسألة المخلوق, and forbidding asking the مخلوق, the creation of Allah. Part of it is to stop having this attachment of the heart, or enslaving the heart to other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, فَإِذَا فَرَغْتَ فَانْصَبْ وَإِلَى رَبِّكَ فَرَغْ. If you're done, فَانْصَبْ, then be upright. If you're done from what? If you're done from the ibadah, فَانْصَبْ to the ibadah. If you're done with one worship, do another act of worship. If you're done with what you're busy with, do act of worship. And وَإِلَى رَبِّكَ فَارْغَبْ, and to your Lord, فَارْغَبْ. رَغْبَة is to have that zeal, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the only one that you want from, and not from the human beings, but only from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and all of the hearts of the human beings are in the power of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the hadith of Ibn Abbas radiallahu anhu, إِذَا سَأَلْتَ فَاسْأَلِنَا. Very clear, if you ask, ask Allah. وَإِذَا اسْتَعَنْتَ فَاسْتَعِنْ بِاللَّهِ. If you seek help from Allah. So the Ibrahim alayhi salam, when he said, فَبِتَغُوا عِنْدَ اللَّهِ الرِّزْقِ. When he said, فَبِتَغُوا, seek عِنْدَ اللَّهِ, with Allah الرِّزْق. The provision. He said, فَبِتَغُوا, he did not say, as he says here, فَلَمْ يَقُلْ وَلَمْ يَقُلْ فَبِتَغُوا الرِّزْقَ عِنْدَ اللَّهِ. He did not say, seek the provisions from Allah. He said, seek from Allah the provisions. What's the difference? This is the issue of the structure of the sentence. When there is taqdeem and ta'khir, the order of the words has a great meaning of, as he says, لِأَنَّ تَقْدِيمَ الظَّرْفِ يُشْعِرُ بِالِاخْتِصَاصِ وَالْحَصْرِ. When عِنْدَ اللَّهِ is mentioned first, that means what? This is exclusiveness. That means you can understand, someone might understand from the table risk, seek the provisions. With Allah, a person might think, maybe there might be some exception to other than Allah. No. When it comes to Allah first, that means there is no chance to ask that from other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, which basically, as if he said, لا تبتغوا الرزق إلا عند الله. Do not seek provisions except with Allah, from Allah. Like لا إله إلا الله. لا إله إلا الله means there's no one worthy worship except Allah. Is it permissible to worship other than Allah? The answer is no. Can you worship Allah and worship other than Allah? You know, sometimes like this, sometimes like that. 99% worship of Allah, 1% worshiping other than Allah. That's a mushrik. He worship Allah day and night, but he makes sujood to asanam just one time a day. He's a mushrik. Right? So, this is what the ayah means. لا تبتغوا الرزق إلا عند الله. Do not seek the provisions itself from Allah. Some people will think that, but we go work for people, we ask people to be hired, as if you just, you know, a few minutes ago we were talking about what? The freedom of the heart versus the enslavement of the heart. The heart has no space, should have no space for any makhluk. No makhluk whatsoever to be present in the heart, seeking anything. So when a person's heart is seeking only the provisions from Allah, physically, you will go apply here and apply there and work there, but your heart is not seeking anything from them. And you will treat them with good manners and say all kinds of good things. This is nothing. Actually, you work even harder than anyone else. But the heart, you seek in the provisions from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And he says, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَاسْأَلُ اللَّهَ مِنْ فَضْلِهِ. This is an important matter. Ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala from his bounty. And the last part of this point, he said, وَالْإِنسَانُ لَابُدَّ لَهُ مِنْ حُصُولِ مَا يَحْتَجُ لَيْهِ مِنْ رِزْقُ لَحْمُ. So the human being, he has to have what he needs from his provisions and risk and the like of this. وَدَفْعِ مَا يَضُرُّهُ أَنْ تَبُشَّ وَيْدَ هَارْ فُمْ هِمْ وَكِلَ الْأَمْرَيْنِ شُرِعَ لَهُ أَنْ يَكُونَ دُعَاءُ لِلَّهِ. With these two matters, to seek what is benefiting and to push away what's harmful, then the shara' and the deen of Allah is that you ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for it. فَلَا يَسْأَلْ. Clear statement. فَلَا يَسْأَلُ رِزْقَهُ إِلَّا مِنَ اللَّهِ. He should not ask his provisions except from Allah. وَلَا يَشْتَكِ إِلَّا إِلَيْهِ. He does not complain to other than Allah. كَمَا قَالَ يَعْقُوبُ إِنَّنَا أَشْكُو بَثِّي وَحُزْنِي إِلَى اللَّهِ. When Yaqub said, I only complain and I express my grief to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone. And this is what he mentioned of الصبر الجميل and الهجر الجميل وصفح الجميل. These words in the Quran. How can the boycotting become beautiful and how the pardoning becomes beautiful and how the sabr becomes beautiful. Al-Hajj al-Jameel, Hajj bila adha, when you boycott without harm. Al-Safh al-Jameel, pardoning without blaming and reminding people of what they did. Al-Sabr al-Jameel, Sabr bighayri shakwa il-makhluk. When a person is patient without complaining to the makhluk, to the creation of Allah. But that's not the one that a sick person going to the doctor, that I have pain here, I have pain there. That's not shakwa. That's not complaining to a makhluk. Right, this is something that is, you know, it depends. Maybe in his heart he's having like this, Allah knows best. In his heart, he's seeking everything from Allah, part of that is that means. And as is mentioned about Imam Muhammad, رحمه الله, في مرضي أبي طاووس كان يكره قيل له. It was said to him in his, when he was sick, that طاووس كان يكره أنين المريض. That one of the تابعين طاووس, they said he used to hate or dislike the painful noise of the sick person, the moaning of a sick person. وَيَقُولِ إِنَّهُ شَكْرًا. He said, this is كان بشكر as if it's complete. فما أن أحمد حتى مات. So أحمد رحمه الله when he heard this, he did not make noise of pain. Even though it's permissible in its, you know, original sense, but they used to complete themselves and perfect themselves. And, but as for complaining to Allah, that does not negate the sorrow. And that's the thing that can be wide open for the believers. When a person not complaining about the qadr of Allah, but when a person, as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned about Ya'qub alayhi salam, and what Ayyub alayhi salam, he said, إِنِّي مَسَّنِيَ الضُّرُّ وَأَنْتَ أَرْحَمُ الرَّحِيمُ. He said, my Lord, harm afflicted me, and you are the most merciful. Is that complaining? No, he's saying to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he did not even ask. He said, oh Allah, harm afflicted me, and you are the most merciful. And Umar ibn al-Khattab, when he mentioned about the surah, the ayah of Surah Yusuf, وَكَانَ عُمَرُ بْنُ الْخَطَّابِ رَضِيَ اللَّهُ عَنْهُ يَقْرَأُ فِي الْفَجْرِ بِسُورَةِ يُونُسِ وَيُوسُفُ وَالنَّحْلِ. He used to recite in Surah Al-Fajr, Surah Yunus, Surah Yusuf, Surah Al-Nahl. فَمَرَّ بِهَذِهِ الْآيَةِ فِي قِرَاءَتِهِ. When he reached this ayah, إِنَّمَا أَشْكُو بَثِّي وَحُزْنِي إِلَى اللَّهِ. I complain or I express my grief to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, what Ya'qub alayhi salam said, حَتَّى سُمِعَ نَشِيجُهُ مِنْ آخِرِ الصُّفُوفِ. Till people would hear the sound of the crying or the weeping of Umar radiallahu anhu from the end of the lines of the masjid, that he was overpowered with tears because of this. And he mentioned the hadith, even though the hadith is weak, but it always mentioned with this meaning, Allahumma alayka ashku da'fa quwwati wa qillat hilati. When the Prophet ﷺ went to Ta'if and the people rejected him, and he said to Allah, I complain to you the weakness of my strength, wa qillat hilati, and that I don't have any hila, no means for me. وَهَوَانِ عَلَى النَّاسِ. And how people, they belittle me, or إِلَى مَنْ تَكِلُونِي. To who do you make me rely upon? إِلَى بَعِيدٍ يَتَجَهَّمُونِي أَمْ إِلَى عَدُوٍ مَلَّكْتَهُ أَمْرِي. إِلَّا لَكُنْ بِكَ غَضَبٌ عَلَيَّ فَلَا أُبَالِي. That you would let me to be with someone that is an enemy or someone far away, that means to other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It's not, you know, not translating things here in the proper way. If, and he would ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, if there is no anger upon me, then I don't care. If it's not your anger, then I don't care. غير أن عافيتك أوسع لي. Even though your strength is what is spacious enough for me till the end. And also ولا حول ولا قوة إلا بالله. وكلما, then he says, وكلما قوي طمع العبد في فضل الله ورحمته ورجائه لقضاء حاجته ودفع مرضته قويت عبوديته له. How is that related to the ubudiyyah? It's very clear. The more the person is seeking from Allah, for the bounties of Allah, and the mercy of Allah, and hoping for the rewards of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and asking Allah to take care of his affairs and so on, and to push away his heart, his ubudiyyah becomes more strong. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants that from the makhluk. وَحُرْيَتِهِ مِمَّا سِوَىٰهِ. He become free from other than Allah. He's not going to be enslaved to other than Allah. فكما أن طمعه في المخلوق يوجب عبوديته له. So since when you want something from the مخلوق, from the creation of Allah, then you become a slave to that person. فيأسه منه يوجب الغنى قلبيا. And when you give up, you don't want anything from him, you become rich in your heart. And it says, استغني عمن شئت تكن نظيرا. Don't depend on anyone, you'll be like him. وَأَفْضِلْ عَلَى مَنْ شِئْتَ تَكُنْ أَمِيرًا. Be better than someone else, you'll be his amir. وَحْتَجْ إِلَى مَنْ شِئْتَ تَكُنْ أَسِيرًا. Be in need of anyone, you become captive to that one that you need something from him. So this is the more the person perfect or complete his ubudiyyah to Allah, the more that his heart will turn away from being attached to other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And as he says, وَعْرَاضُ قَلْبِي عَنِ الطَّلَبِ مِنَ اللَّهِ وَمَجَاءِ لَهِ يُوجِبُ صُرَاقَ قَلْبِهِ. عن العبودية لله. The person doesn't ask Allah for rizq and for provisions and all of these things, then his heart will turn away from the worship of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, especially if he's hoping for the makhluk and he's not hoping from the khaliq subhanahu wa ta'ala. He says, بحيث يكون قلبه معتمدا إما على رئاسته. The heart is relying upon the fact that he is a leader and he has armies and deputies and wealth, or he relies upon his family and his friends, or his money. He has lots of money, so he relying upon this with his heart. Or many things that people rely upon. Or his servant, or his shaykh, or whatever there is. Or someone that even died or maybe alive. Right? And that's why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, وَتَوَكَّلْ عَلَى الْحَيِّ الَّذِي لَا يَمُوتُ. Rely upon the one that is the ever-living, that one that never dies, وَسَبِّحْ بِحَمْدِهِ. And praise the glory of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَكَفَى بِهِ بِذُنُوبِ عِبَادِهِ خَبِيرًا. And therefore, وَكُلِّ مَنْ عَلَّقَ قَلْبَهُ بِالْمَخْلُوقِينَ. Every person that his heart is attached to the makhlukin, the creation of Allah, أَنْ يَنْصُرُوا, that they would help him and give him victory. أَوْ يَرْزُقُوا, or provide for him. أَوْ يَهْدُوا, or guide him. خَضَعَ قَلْبُهُ لَهُ. He submit his heart to them. وصار فيه من العبودية لهم بقدر ذلك. And becoming his heart, عبودية, servitude to them according to how much his heart is attached to them. And then when we apply this, does a Muslim need any other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? The answer is no. Only needs Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Only ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Physically, again, the body can do whatever halal means, but the heart does not need from anyone, does not believe that victory and help and all of that can come from other than Allah, only comes from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. يقول, even if a person is like this, وَإِنْ كَانَ فِي الظَّاهِرِ أَمِيرًا لَهُ مُدَبِّرًا لِأُمُورِهِمْ, that person becomes enslaved to this creation of Allah, even if he is their Amir, even if he is their leader. فَالْعَاقِلُ يَنْظُرُ, this is another quote from, it was mentioned, فَالْعَاقِلُ يَنْظُرُ إِلَى الْحَقَائِقِ لَا إِلَى الظَّوَاهِرِ. العاقل, the person of intellect, he looks into the reality of things, not the apparent things. What makes us different than the cows and the camels and everything? They have eyes and they see. We have eyes and we see. But what's the difference? The difference is that the human being, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, gave him reason and intellect, so that he is not deceived by the ظواهر, by the apparent things. He needs to see the reality of it. فَالْرَجُلُ إِذَا تَعَلَّقَ قَلْبُهُ بِمْرَأَةٍ, if the man, his heart is attached to a woman, وَلَوْ كَانَتْ مُبَحَلًا, even if it's permissible for him, يَبْقَ قَلْبُهُ أَسِيرًا لَهَا تَحْكُمُ فِيهِ وَتَتَصَرَّفُ بِهِ وَتُرِيدُ. His heart becomes attached to it, she is in charge, and she do whatever she wants. وَهُوَ فِي الظَّاهِرِ سَيِّدُهَا, and in the apparent look that he's the one in charge of her, because he's her husband also. وَلَكِنَّهُ فِي الْحَقِيقَةِ هُوَ أَسِيرُهَا وَمَمْلُوكَهَا, but in reality, he is captive to her. وَلَا سِيَّمَا إِذَا عَلِمَتْ بِفَقْرِهِ إِلَيْهَا وَعِشْقِهِ لَهَا, especially if she knows that he is so much attached to her and he loves her so much, that's if she's not a person of goodness, right? وَأَنَّهُ لَا يَعْتَضُ عَنَ الْغَيْهِ فَإِنَّهَا حِنَائِدٍ تَتَحَكَّمُ فِيهِ تَحَكُّمُ السَّيِّدِ الْقَاهِرِ الظَّالِمِ, she becomes in charge and so on. بَلْ أَعْظَمُ فَإِنَّ أَسْرَ الْقَلْبِ أَعْظَمُ مِنْ أَسْرِ الْبَدَنِ. Another quote from Sheikh Santamir to remember. فَإِنَّ أَسْرَ الْقَلْبِ, the captivity of the heart, أَعْظَمُ, much bigger than أَسْرِ الْبَدَنِ, than the physical captivity. Yusuf عليه السلام was in prison, and Fir'aun was, you know, not the one at the time of Musa عليه السلام. Musa عليه السلام was a free man in prison, and Fir'aun was enslaved when he would say that he is the ruler of the alameen. So it's the matter about what's in the heart. And how even when Yusuf عليه السلام, when they came to get him out of prison, right, and what did he say? That's the king is issuing for him to come out, and anybody would be happy if the Prophet mentioned that in the meaning of the hadith, that if it's anyone, the person gets the leniency from the king, get out of the prison, he would get out of the prison. But Yusuf عليه السلام said, قَالَ ارْجِعْ إِلَى رَبِّكَ فَاسْأَلْهُ مَا بَالُ النِّسْوَةِ الَّتِي قَطَّعْنَا أَيْدِيَهُنَّ. He didn't want to come out of prison by the afu, or by the pardoning of the king. He wants to come out by being innocent, by being honored that he did not do anything wrong. So he said, go back and ask these women of what happened, so that he comes out by being declared that he's innocent, not that he came out because he was forgiven or pardoned. This is how the heart has that free heart, not enslaved to anything. So, and also, وَاسْتِعْبَادُ الْقَلْبِ أَعْظَمْ مِنْ اسْتِعْبَادُ الْبَدَنِ. So the istibad is to be, the heart to be enslaved, is much worse than the enslavement of the physical body. فَإِنَّ مَنْ اسْتُعْبِدَ بَدَنَا وَاسْتُرِقَ وَأُسْرِبْ لَا يُبَالِي إِذَا كَانَ قَلْبُهُ مُسْتَرِيحًا مِنْ ذَلِكَ مُطْمَئِنًا بَلْ يُمْكِنُ الْخِيرُ بِالْخَاصِ. If someone is physically in captivity or imprisoned, he does not really care if his heart is free, is comfort, that he is, you know, and this is why Shaykh Santana himself, when he entered the prison, اني دايما بدرسهم اني سد نافع ولا في مسكوت فهم نافع ولا اعتقدني what my enemies would do with me سجني خلوة you imprison me this is خلوة to be alone with my عبادة مرسل الله سبحانه وتعالى نفي سياحة if they expel him he's having tourism going around doing things and so on قتل شهادة if they kill me this is martyrdom so they cannot do anything they cannot enslave him his enemies cannot enslave him because the heart is turning to Allah سبحانه وتعالى يقول أما إذا كان القلب الذي هو ملك الجسم رقيقا مستعبدا this heart supposed to be the king of the rest of the body if this heart is enslaved متيما لغير الله love other than Allah فهذا هو الذل this is the real humility والأسر المحض and the absolute captivity والعبودية الذليلة لما استعبدها and the real humility is when a person's heart is like this so again how this is related to the عبودية الله سبحانه وتعالى and he mentioned this and then he says فالحرية حرية القلب والعبودية عبودية القلب so a person has to agree based on these facts that freedom is the freedom of the heart and slavery is the slavery of the heart this is what the reality of it. Does that mean that a person loves to be physically enslaved? Of course not and whoever understands this that means he's not using his reason in a proper way but to make sure that a person value the reality of things. But many of the hadith of the Prophet ﷺ gives these meanings. As the hadith of the Prophet ﷺ, ليس الغنى عن كثرة العرب وإنما الغنى غنى النفس. The غنى richness is not by having lots of wealth. But الغنى the richness is when the nafs, oneself is rich, when a person is content. And he said, وهذا لعمر الله إذا كان قد استعبد قلبه صورة مباحة فأما من استعبد قلبه صورة محرمة. This is if it's even permissible. If it's something haram, like a woman and things like this, فَهَذَا هُوَ الْعَذَابُ الَّذِي لَا يُدَنِي عَذَابُ This is the torment, this is punishment, there is nothing is the right of it. And he talks about the عُشَّاق الصُّور, those who are in love and attachment to the images. And the صُور meaning human beings, being attached, you know, in a haram way to the images of others. And we have been tested with this in our life, with all of these images. The haram images and so on, how the effect of it in the heart, and the heart becomes enslaved, you know, with all of the different corruption and evil that would fill the heart, that became makes the heart attached to other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and then people complain why that is, then it leads to atheism and things like this. When the heart is being enslaved to other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and this is something that he mentioned in this. The last point, inshallah ta'ala, and we still have like 20 pages left. To start when we start, page number 90, he said, وَمِنْ أَعْرَمِ إِسْلَابِ هَذَا الْبَلَاءِ One of the most great reason of this bala or this calamity to the heart we just mentioned, إِعْرَادُ الْقَلْبِ عَنِ اللَّهِ When the heart turns away from Allah, فَإِنَّ الْقَلْبَ إِذَا ذَاقَ طَعْمَ عِبَادَةِ اللَّهِ وَالْإِخْلَصِ لَهِ Because the heart, if it tasted the sweetness of the worship of Allah, and to be sincere for the sake of Allah, لم يكن عنده شيء قط أحلى من ذلك. Nothing is more sweetness or sweet to the heart than this. ولا ألذ ولا أمتع ولا أطيب. No more pleasure. Anything other than this. And as he says, والإنسان لا يترك محبوبا. That's another law. والإنسان لا يترك محبوبا إلا بمحبوب آخر يكون أحب إليه منه. أو خوفا من مكروه. The human being does not leave something he loves unless it's for something else he loves it more or some fear that he feels. فالحب الفاسد إنما ينصرف القلب عنه بالحب الصالح أو بالخوف من الضر. So if a person has been afflicted with a corrupted love, he loves something haram, he loves someone that is not permissible for him outside the fold of marriage with them, or he loves some sin or do whatever. His heart is attached to it and he keeps on coming back to it. How to cure this heart is by having the love of something righteous to work on the love of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. فَالْحُبُّ الْفَاسِدْ إِنَّمَا يَنْصَرِفُ الْقَلْبُ عَنْ If it's a corrupted one, the heart will turn away from it with the righteous love. أَوْ بِالْخَوْفِ مِنَ الضَّرَرِ Or the fear of harm would happen. And that's what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said to Yusuf, about Yusuf alayhi salam, كَذَلِكَ لِنَصْرِفْ عَنْهُ السُّوءَ وَالْفَحْشَاءَ إِنَّهُ مِنْ عِبَادِنَا الْمُخْلَصِينَ This is how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala diverted his heart from the evil and sin. Because indeed he is from our slaves and mukhlaseen, those who were pure. purified. فالله يصرف عن عبده ما يسوءه. الله سبحانه وتعالى is the one that divert his slave from al-mail and to be inclined and attached to the images and to the other than Allah سبحانه وتعالى and push that away from him. ولهذا يكون قبل أن يذوق حلاوة العبودية لله والإخلاص له بحيث تغلب نفسه على اتباع هواها. فإذا ذاق طعم الإخلاص وقوي في قلبه انقهر له باب العلاج الإخلاص, the sincerity, and that's by seeking help from Allah سبحانه وتعالى and turning to Allah سبحانه وتعالى. So and then الصلاة فيها pushes away matters of evil and has the ذكر of Allah سبحانه وتعالى. And والقلب خلق يحب الحق ويريده ويطلبه. That's by the mercy of Allah. The heart is created to love الحق, to love the truth, and seek the حق and want to be upon the حق. And this is something that we all have to know, especially when it comes to the da'wah to others. Human beings, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created them to want to have the truth. They love the truth. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created them like this. In every human being, they love the truth and they want it and they're seeking it. But then what happens? They block that haqq from themselves, whether it's from the ways of shaitan, he makes the haqq, it doesn't look like haqq, it looks like batil, or the diseases of the heart. Corruption of the heart, a person corrupts his heart. Kibr, arrogance. That's corrupting the heart. The heart is sick. So he's not able to see the truth, he does not have the ability to want the truth. But his original state when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created him, that's why even the word al-haqq, everybody would like the word al-haqq. Everybody like to be one, the truth. But what is the truth? This is something else. And he says here, فَلَمَّا عَرَضَتْ لَهُ إِرَادَةِ الشَّرِّ طَلَبَ دَفْعَ لَهُ. When the heart, some evil comes to it, he wants to push it away. فَإِنَّهَا تُفْسِدُ الْقَلْبَ كَمَا يُفْسِدُ الزَّرْعَ بِمَا يَمْهُتُ فِي مِنَ الدَّغَلِ. Because the evil corrupts the heart like the plants, the weeds and the like of it, corrupts it. And the عبودية and the wealth and the leadership and so on and so on for كذلك. One last thing really in this time, inshallah. وهكذا أيضا طالب المال فإن ذلك المال, page number 92, فإن ذلك المال يستعبده ويستهلكه. The one that wants money, this money or this wealth enslaves him. وهذه الأمور نوعان, and these matters have two types of it. One, ما يحتاج العبد إليه, what a person needs. كما يحتاج إليه من طعام وشراب ومسكن وكحل, food, drink, shelter, relations and so on. What to do with these necessities that we all need? What to do with it? فهذا يطلبه من الله. Ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for this. Ask Allah for your food and your drink and your shelter and everything. ويرغب إليه, and to seek that from Allah. فيكون المال عنده يستعمله في حاجته. So the wealth becomes with him. And this is again, it's all heart. Right? So that nobody would say that means throw it away. Nobody would ever, some mind would say this. يكون عنده من منزلة حماره الذي يركبه وبساطه الذي يجلس عليه بل من منزلة الكنيف الذي يجلس في حاجته. The wealth becomes like the donkey that he rides, the piece of cloth that he sits on, or even the bathroom that he relieves himself in. من غير أن يستعبده. Does anybody worship his bathroom? Is your heart is attached to the bathroom? No, you go to the bathroom to relieve yourself and you need it by necessity. Everybody needs to relieve himself. If anybody is deprived from this, the most painful thing. But does the heart get attached to that action? You love it. I mean, this is what your life is all about. Of course not. So this is how the wealth should be in the heart. Is it something difficult? It's not if a person is understanding the meanings of al-Ubudiyya and worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and seek help from Allah. And therefore he becomes halu'a, as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said about the human beings, those who do not establish the salah. إِذَا مَسَّهُ الشَّرُّ جَزُوعًا وَإِذَا مَسَّهُ الْخَيْرُ مَنُوعًا. How the human beings are. If evil afflicts him, he's terrified. And if good happens to him, he's withholding stuff, he becomes greedy. So this is the necessities. What to do with the necessities? Only ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for it in your heart, and you ask, of course you take the needs. The other type, مَا لَا يَحْتَاجُ الْعَبْدُ إِلَيْهِ. For when it comes to what you are not, when you're not, the things that you're not in need of. فَهَذَا لَا يَنْبَغِي لَهُ أَنْ يُعَلِّقَ قَلْبَهُ. If you don't need it, then you should not have your hearts attached to it. How many things we don't need it in our life, and you find hearts attached to it? A phone, or this, or that, or, you know, these silly things that we find ourselves so much attached when a person doesn't really need it. فَإِذَا عَلَّقَ قَلْبَهُ بِهِ صَارَ مُسْتَعْبَدًا لَهُ. If his heart is attached to it, he becomes enslaved to it. وَرُبَّمَ صَارَ مُعْتَمِدًا عَلَى غَيْرِ اللَّهِ. And maybe that he would rely upon other than Allah. فَلَا يَرْقَ مَعُهُ حَقِيقَةَ الْعِبَادَةِ لَهُ. Then it would not left with him the reality of the worship of Allah. Or حَقِيقَةَ, see the word حَقِيقَةَ is mentioned. Not that he would not worship Allah, but the reality of it, the essence of it. And the same thing, حَقِيقَةَ التَّوَكُّلِ, the real relying upon Allah. بَلْ فِيهِ شُعْبَةٌ مِنْ عِبَادَةِ لَغَيْرِ اللَّهِ. He has a part that is worshipping other than Allah, but not necessarily in the shirk category. وَشُعْبَةٌ مِنْ التَّوَكُّلِ عَلَى غَيْرِ اللَّهِ. And he has a part that is relying upon other than Allah. وَهَذَا, this is what, going back to the hadith, تَعِسَ عَبْدُ الدِّرْهَمْ, تَعِسَ عَبْدُ الدِّنَارِ, and so on. He's miserable, the one that is enslaved to other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَهَذَا هُوَ عَبْدُ هَذِهِ الْأُمُورِ. He's slaves to all of these things. فَإِنَّهُ لَوْ طَلَبَهَا مِنَ اللَّهِ. If he asks these things from Allah, فَإِنَّ اللَّهَ إِذَا أَعْطَاهُ إِيَا رَضِيهِ. If Allah gives it to him, he's pleased. وَإِذَا مَنَعَهُ إِيَا سَخِيَ. The bad one, he would be displeased. وَإِنَّمَا عَبْدُ اللَّهِ, the one that worships Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then يُرْضِيهِ مَا يُرْضِي اللَّهِ وَيُسْخِطُهُ مَا يُسْخِطُ اللَّهِ. The عَبْدُ اللَّهِ, he's pleased what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is pleased with, and he's displeased with what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is displeased with. He loves what Allah loves, he loves what the Messenger loves, he hates what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala hates, he supports and loyal to those who are loyal to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and so on. مَنْ أَحَبَّ لِلَّهِ وَأَبْغَضَ لِلَّهِ وَأَعْطَى لِلَّهِ وَمَنَعَ لِلَّهِ فَقَدْ اسْتَكْمَلَ الْإِيمَانَ. As the Prophet said, whoever gives, loves for the sake of Allah, hates for the sake of Allah, gives for the sake of Allah, withholds for the sake of Allah, that means what moves them is the deen of Allah. فَقَدْ اسْتَكْمَلَ الْإِيمَانَ وَأَوْفَى الْإِيمَانَ. So, and the last statement, inshallah, we'll continue that tomorrow, inshallah, ta'ala, near 93. فَكَانَ هَذَا, after he mentioned the hadith, also the three, those who would find the sweetness of al-Iman, يقول, فَكَانَ هَذَا مِنْ تَنَامِ حُبِّهِ لِلَّهِ. فَإِنَّ, another law to consider, فَإِنَّ مَحَبَّةَ مَحْبُوبِ الْمَحْبُوبِ مِنْ تَنَامِ مَحَبَّةِ الْمَحْبُوبِ. What does that mean? That if you love Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you would love what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala loves. This is by necessity. So if a person wants to see if he loves Allah or not, because to perfect the love of Allah, he said, فَإِنَّ مَحَبَّةَ مَحْبُوبِ الْمَحْبُوبِ. The love of what you love is from the perfection of the love of what you love. Does it make sense? Like if a person loves someone, the perfect love is that you love what that person loves. So if a person loves Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then he has to love what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala loves. If he hates what Allah loves, there's a major problem, a disease that he needs to cure his heart from. فَإِذَا أَحَبَّ أَنْبِيَاءَ اللَّهِ وَأَوْلِيَاءَ اللَّهِ لِأَجْلِ قِيَامِهِ بِمَحْبُوبَاتِ الْحَقِّ لَا لِشَيْءٍ آخَرَ فَقَدْ أَحَبَّهُمْ دَيْنَ غَيْرِ. Why do we love the prophets of Allah? Because they fulfilled what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala loves. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said about those who renegate away from the deen, الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا مَنْ يَرْتَدَّ مِنْكُمْ عَنْ دِينِهِ فَسَوْفَ يَأْتِ اللَّهُ بِقَوْمٍ يُحِبُّهُمْ وَيُحِبُّونَهُ أَذِلَّةٍ عَلَى الْمُؤْمِنِينَ عِزَّةٍ عَلَى الْكَافِرِينَ. That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will bring other people, they love him and he loves them. They are humble to the believers, turn against the disbelievers. And the ayah قُلْ إِن كُنْتُمْ تُحِبُّونَ اللَّهَ فَاتَّبِعُونِي يُحْبِبْكُمُ اللَّهُ. Say Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, if you love Allah, then follow me. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala would love you. فَإِنَّ الرَّسُولَ لَا يَأْمُرُ إِلَّا بِمَا يُحِبُّ اللَّهُ. The Prophet ﷺ will never order you to do anything unless it's what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala loves. وَلَا يَنْهَى إِلَّا عَمَّا يُبْغِضُهُ اللَّهُ. And anything that is forbidden is because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala hates. وَلَا يَفْعَلْ إِلَّا مَا يُحِبُّهُ اللَّهُ. The actions of the Prophet ﷺ is what Allah loves. وَلَا يُخْبِرُ إِلَّا بِمَا يُحِبُّ اللَّهُ وَتَصْدِيقُ بِهِ. And anything that he informs us is because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala loves for us to believe in it. فَمَنْ كَانَ مُحِبًّا لِلَّهِ, whoever loves Allah, لَزِمَ أَنْ يَتَّبِعَ رَسُولَهُ. He has to, by necessity, follow the Messenger. فَيُصَدِّقُهُ فِيمَا أَخْبَرَ, so he believes him in what he informs. وَيُطِيعُهُ فِيمَا أَمَرَ, he obeys him in what he ordered. وَيَتَأَسَّى بِهِ فِيمَا فَعَلَ, and he take him as a role model and example in all of his actions. وَمَنْ فَعَلَ هَذَا فَقَدْ فَعَلَ مَا يُحِبُّهُ اللَّهُ وَيُحِبُّهُ اللَّهُ. Whoever does this, he did what Allah loves, and therefore Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala loves him. Where is the sin in all of this? It will come. Yes, a person with all of this perfect love to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, asking only Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and so on, he's a human being. He has weakness, he falls into the sin, immediately he repents to Allah. But if he intentionally and continue without repenting to Allah, that weakens his iman and the love of Allah. As the hadith of the Prophet ﷺ, and this is a sound hadith, Musa bin Ahmad and others, that ما أخشى عليكم الفقر ولكن أخشى عليكم التكاثر. With that word, I don't fear poverty for you, I fear for you piling up, piling more and more and so on. وما أخشى عليكم الخطأ ولكن أخشى عليكم العمد. He said عليه الصلاة والسلام, I don't fear for you mistakes. Al-Khata comes onto also the category of sins. But I fear for you al-amd, the intentional ones. The ones that a person, when it's intentional, that means he would not repent to Allah, who plans to repent to Allah. Intentional sins, planning for it and continue to be in it, and so on. So the believers, their sins is, yes, they fall into sins and immediately repent to Allah. Weakness, things like this. And also, if a person intentionally commits a sin, it doesn't make him a disbeliever, but that weakens the iman and weakens the ubudiyyah to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the love of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in our hearts. So stop here inshaAllah ta'ala. This is page 94. And continue inshaAllah ta'ala tomorrow afternoon.